Alright, so I'll give you like a little secret. I'm actually not utilizing all of it yet, but the survival in Texas, good God, because it's so expensive. Okay. Yeah, I'm thinking more expensive than California. Like on lots of things, vegetables, fruits, especially organics are very pricey. If you're gonna buy conventional, then I don't know. I guess they throw it across the river or something. But here, in for organic, it's steep. So I'm like, well, okay, I've got to cut the costs. So I'm baking bread. Yeah, no more. I'm not buying any more of those expensive rusticas. Baking bread. That's every third day. I'm running with the sourdough mixture. Now to make the sourdough mix, it's very simple. You just take your regular bread dough, like you're making a loaf. You take a little bit of it, you know, about a cup of it, and you put it in water, and you just let it hang out there for 3 or 4 days, and then it starts to get sour. And then after that, you put it into the refrigerator, and each time you pull out a cup of that, and then you add another cup of this flour and another water, and then you let it hang out a little bit more, and then it gets more sour, and then you put it back in. But each time, this you only let it hang out like a half a day, because you don't want it to turn green or moldy or anything like that. And that's supposed to be no yeast use after that, but I'm still using a little yeast. And each time I bake a loaf, you take a little bit off that loaf and you add it into the old sourdough mix. So each time, so it has like a fresh feed. That's important also, because it adapts to, I don't know, kind of your style of bread, you know, where you're headed. So that's a real save. You have no idea. Just baking your bread is a great save. It does take a little time, because you have to, if you're a self-kneader, I'm a self-kneader, I knead my hand. So it does take, you know, a good half hour, 45 minutes, the whole process. And then, you know, remember to get that oven hot in the beginning, like 500 degrees. You put the water, a pound of water underneath. You get that 500 for about 15 minutes. And it just takes that loaf and it makes it go woof and it gets the bloom. And then for 15 minutes after that, you lower it to like 375 or 350. So that type of bread is easy, quick to cook. It's only 30 minutes, and it's very delicious. You can add seeds, you can add walnuts, almonds, whatever, you know, nuts you have on hand, or you can add raisins. So not a bad way to go, and that can save like $40, $50 a month just alone, just on your bread budget. So yeah, bread is a costly little bugger. And other things, okay, other ways to save, because yeah, we're talking expensive here to live, property tax wise. We have beans, any of the pulses family. Like, you keep those going. You have the black beans, you have the navy beans, you have the black-eyed peas. You have the garbanzos, you have the pinto, and I believe there's another one, there's another white bean out there, it's pretty common. Fava beans also. So you get those, and just, you have to always keep that pot, you have a pot around, like a fresh one that is just soaking the beans. And I have not had luck with the pinto beans, actually, because sometimes I get the feeling they have varying ages, you know, when you buy them. Some are fresh, some aren't fresh, and they'll go like for an hour. And I'm like, well, normally that's fine, but if I do like you know, I cook them for an hour after they've done their pre-soak. I do a quick boil. A quick boil for 5 minutes. I turn it off. I let it soak for 4 hours, and then cook for about an hour. But I've had some pinto beans that have been like, nuh-uh, never gonna cook. We are never going to cook, and they're just dry and they never go through. And those beans, I don't know how they even ended up in my bunch of beans that I have, but they're there. But yeah, but so with all of those, you got the legumes, you have the split peas, and you have the lentils, and you have to use all of those little spices. You have the curries, the corianders. You've got to use all of those in mixtures. Add in your oreganos, add in your basils. This is all making cheaper soups because, oh my gosh, there's a soup over there at one of those stores, and it was $8, $9, yeah, $9, and yeah, that's not necessary. Okay, so you do that, and then you add your you know, your vegetables later at the end of all of this, and then you end up with some kind of a brothy thing, or you just keep them separate, and you have your rice. You make your rice separate from your beans, and so you always keep those things going. So then you always have a food supply, and it's not expensive. Okay, this is not expensive. So that's one way to fight the property tax of Texas, is only cook at home and bake your own bread. Cook your own beans, make your own rice, and do not eat out. That's one way to fight it. It's kind of a solitary state if that's what it's asking everybody to do, is to go be Amish, go back to Mormon years. It's kind of a solitary state for people that are homeowners, I'm finding, because my gosh, yeah. Once you're on a budget, a fixed budget, I cannot. And I don't like seeing old people work either. I hate it, actually. Once they're on a fixed budget, you know. Yeah. Anyway, I know. I'm not sure I'm helping. But yeah, the frugality of this state, this caused state. What else do we have? Well, showering. You cannot shower as often. You have to shower like twice a week. Twice a week. You know, that really lowers the water use, especially as a gardener. You know, if you do, and then also as a gardener, if you have the drip irrigation, that lowers the water use because you have to look at it as like you have an extra person in your house. When you have the garden, it's the same water usage as an extra person that lives there. With the toilet flushing, the what do we call it, the sink flow, the showers. Yeah, it's about 800 gallons a year, a month, at least. So when you've got this 800 gallons going, and I've got so many little trees. I've got apricots and peaches and pears and apples and plums. I have oranges. I have mandarins, lemons, roses, all of these things. Avocados, all of these things are just starting to gel, you know, they're young trees, but they're starting to gel on their little épaulier. Raspberry bushes and blackberry bushes. Who did I miss? rhubarbs, grapes, blueberries. Oh, I'm getting set up, man. I'm getting set up because, my God, it's expensive in Texas. So, oh, an olive tree. I got an olive tree for the front garden, and it's a big beauty for Spain. It's a Spanish olive tree, and it's one of those that starts making little baby olives this year already. So it's going to have olives drop off, and so that'll be an olive collector tree. So all of those things. It's a little bit pricey to start a garden, you know, that's a food feeder, a food provider. It's a little pricey, but if you have the time, my gosh, it does cut down on the costs a lot. Yeah, anyway. What else? Did I miss anything? Any special foods that I have out there? I don't think so. I have a lot of like special things like lettuces and kales and carrots, and I have potatoes growing, and I have the Brussels sprouts, the broccoli, the cauliflowers. I also have, back to the potatoes, the red potatoes, sweet potatoes, back to, and the tomatoes. My tomatoes thus far are playing like hard to get. My tomato bushes, they don't want to be little plants even, so I'm having problems with tomatoes and eggplants being started yet this time. I think the nights are still a little cold. I've had to bring a bunch back in the house. Yeah, I lost a bunch of them. They don't want to be started from seed at this time, and they have to be started from seed, and they have to be like indoors. I'm having a heck of a problem with them. Peppers also, my peppers have grown, and they just stayed. They're stunted at a certain height. I'm like, shh, grow, little peppers, but they are acting stunted. But they're wonderful. The next, I have all the gourd family. I have the zucchinis, the cucumbers, the butternuts, the noix. What do we call those? The potirons, and watermelons and cantaloupes. So good supply of food will be arriving. And so what that means also with frugality is getting back into the beast of preserving. You have got to preserve all of these things somehow. You know, you got to put them in salt, so you have to put them in something sweet. It has to be, you know, all those boiled jars, you know, and that moment. No bananas though. I'm not growing bananas here. Darn it. Yeah. So I'm trying to make a feast garden, but it's a very tiny garden. It's a very tiny garden, and it probably won't establish for a few more years, like really, you know, flourish. And, you know, from the fruits and, yeah, did I say peaches? Of course there's peaches. Just wonderful. And there are little tiny apricots already on the trees. So, and there's little tiny baby peaches. So they're doing their thing. They're doing their thing. So that's a way. That's a way. The drip irrigation systems, I guess if you look at it, I'm talking about $200. You have to just really set aside at least $200 just for the parts, and it's going to be all of the tubing, it's going to be hose repair, it's going to be those little drip emitters, it's going to be what else, Oh my gosh. When I go back to the tubing, I could just shout and scream. There's a company that makes a really, really soft tubing. And it's supple and it bends and it's beautiful and it's online and it's probably not as hardy as the tubing they sell at these big department stores, these building department stores, because it's so soft and supple. But it is so easy to put all of those connectors, because you have to, my hands are hurting, because you have to put all of those connectors together, these T-barbs they call them, and the actual tubing they sell does not fit the T-barb. You have to stretch the tubing to fit each T-barb. So you have to stretch it like with scissors or something, you know, and stretch it out. So it's like a tedious process that they didn't even make the tubing fit the T-barbs. And so that's like, what? And they're the same company, the same tubing, the same barbs, you know, and it doesn't matter. It just does not fit unless you alter the actual tubing, the stiff tubing. So it's really hurtful. It's a very hurtful one. And this really soft, supple tubing they sell on the internet, you can't find it at these stores. And yuck. So that's my advice, is get that soft, supple tubing, at least for half of it. At least for half of it, because you'll just hate yourself midway through, because it is so horrible an experience, because these barbs don't fit, you know. You're like twisting and twisting, you know, with all of your might, you know. Anyway, so so that's very important, though, that to get that irrigation, because once you have it hooked up to one of those program machines, you don't have to water it, because here in this state, in this heat, in this very, very hot place, you have to water after hours. You have to water, you know, early, 5 o'clock in the morning. You cannot water it when the sun ever is out. It's just water just lost immediately. So you have to have these systems, or you'll never have a garden. So anyway, and I've had some terrible finds. You know, I found some splits in the hoses that have had just been made gushers. You know, when I first moved here and I turned on the program system, there were geysers in the back garden. Geysers. It was shooting out of all of those sprinkler heads, and I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm never going to be able to fix this. But I did. I finally fixed it. So now it's just the occasional spot, you know. And sometimes you have to cut these hoses, and you have the guts to cut the hose in half, and then you have like an extender tube that fits in between those two hoses, and then you have to band them tight. Now, I didn't want that version either, but that's all they sell here in these stores. They have another kind that fits over. It's supposed to fit over the tube, but they don't sell that. I was stuck with these bands, the band versions. So, and they leak. They all leak a little. So you have to keep tightening them and tightening them and tightening them. It's not easy. It's not easy being frugal, because you still need to have these basic necessities to really be your own self-sufficient food supply. You need those basic necessities. And anyway, making my own tortillas. My big miss with them right now are the spinach flavored tortillas. Those are so good, and they're so supple. I can make supple tortillas, but not the spinach ones yet. And I know all that is boiled spinach water, and then you pour it in to get the green. I just haven't done it yet. But yeah, those are neat. And to make them big also, that's something difficult at home, is to make the big tortillas. That's not happening with me. I don't even have a rolling pin. I only use like a glass. So no, I don't think that's going to happen. So yeah, but that's how to live in Texas with this property tax. That's really how. And I'm going to commend the local building supply store, both of them, the Big Lowe's, the Big Home Depot. They have not shied away from selling fruits and vegetables, fruit trees. Thank gosh you can go there and get a raspberry bush. You know, thank gosh. You know, all of those things. You know, very helpful. So, yeah. So going off grid, it can cost a little bit, you know, depending on when you want that fruit to start fruiting. It's not really off grid though, is it? Because there's still electricity running through. No, I don't have a solar system. No solar system. What was that? Yeah, I do like solar companies out there on the internet. There was a few, but I don't know if I'm allowed to mention that. And then, so yeah, I don't know how they're doing right now. And there's cannabis companies also available for purchase. So good for that. You can now buy cannabis on the market. And that's kind of funny. I found that very humorous. I think they're not doing well, though. Last time I checked, I believe they have a price. They're being run up a little bit, and they're being batted down. You know, like batted down. You know, they get up to a certain height, and then they get batted down. So I think somebody's playing games with the cannabis companies right now. Anyway, and what do you call that, insider trading? I don't know. Somebody is just trying to stomp on them. And so, when I'm at, did I say as much as I've said? Peas, I'm growing peas and beans also. Did I miss anything? Oh my gosh, it's a lot of work. And the grass is starting to grow on my pathways. So I have my next project, as I have to, on all my pathways. Because when I was first starting my garden and I did my veggie jardin, I just laid down a whole bunch of mulch over the grass. And I figured, well, you know, the light, for a while it won't show. But now I have to actually move all that mulch out, and then I have to dig up that grass and turn it. I just haven't had the time. But yeah, that'll stop the grass from being grass. And no clover luck. I didn't have any clover luck here in Texas yet. There's established clover that's working, but starting new clover from seeds needs so much water. It can be done, but it just really needs a lot of water, and I think later in the season. Don't do it now. That's my advice, because I've gone through two bags of seeds, of clover seeds, and I've just wasted them. You know, they've just gone to dust. So do not do that now. Wait, I would say wait even a month. Yeah, it's a devil to start. It's just a devil. Because it has to be all the time moist. You can't let the clover dry out. So it's a real slow starter. And what else should I say? Cabbages. I'm also growing cabbages. Those red cabbages. and they're slow at the moment, but they're going. And turnips. Beets, turnips, and parsnips. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, and never forget the irises, ever. So yeah, it's like my little children back there. All those my little seeds, my little acorn squashes are like my little children. And always save your seeds from any of those. Always save your seeds. You know, you don't actually have to buy them. If you have a nice organic seed from a fruit or whatever, you can always use that one. I know. No, it's tough to wait for it to become a tree or whatever, but for squashes, it's great. For squashes, it's great, and usually they always work, given the right environment. My one pet peeve is they do not sell organic potting soil for seed starting. I can't find it. And even if I did, it would probably be too expensive. So the one they sell is more like later on in the life of the plant. So somewhere you have to like make your own organic potting soil to make it that thin. You know, it has to be really, really sifty. Anyway, this was a talk about foraging. No, not foraging. About what was that thing? Frugal. Yeah, being frugal in Texas and for survival. Yeah, so it's really a survival state in a very bad way. Yeah, because I call it a bad way because I don't think they should force people who live in the city to be off grid. But that's what's going on. Anyway. Ciao.